So, okay, after the presentation of Christoph, where we see the complicated relationship between Mauser, Leuwe and FN, with Leuwe in between, we're going to take a look at the relationship between Paul Mauser and Georg Luger. For those of you who are not familiar with Georg Luger, he was an Austrian. He was responsible for the improvement of the Borchardt pistol design, which basically became the Luger pistol, named after him, and became the German military pistol and military pistol of a number of countries in the world. The pistol name is matched to his name, but we will see that there is more to Mr. Luger than meets the eye. Just to introduce him, this is a photograph made about 1906-1908 in Berlin. This is Mr. Georg Luger. This is his son, Luger Jr., holding a Luger pistol. And this is Mr. Hoffman, and Hoffman was the foreman of pistol production for DWM before Mr. August Weiss took over. The other people in the photo are local Berlin members of the same shooting club, including a dog and a cardboard picture. This photograph is actually the one of the original prints of this image. It's been reproduced in a number of books during the last century, but this is one I acquired last year, and it turned out to be an original print, so we can show in much more detail what they were holding. So for example, this man is holding a model 1900 Luger, while he is holding the newer 1906 model. But back to Luger. So what happened? In 1891, Leuwe sent a nice letter to Paul Mauser saying, okay, it would be nice if you have some support in the branding of your weapons. And we have a nice young engineer who was formerly the assistant of Mr. von Mandlicher. And he is now working for us, and he can assist you in Italy in trying to get the Mauser rifle accepted in Italy, apart from the Mandlicher. So Mauser agreed. Luger was sent to Oberndorf to familiarize himself with the Mauser systems. And what made Luger so perfect for the job, it seems, was he was a good technician. He knew the Mandlicher rifle because he had worked for Mr. Mandlicher. He was also fluent in Italian, so he was the man to try and flog the Mauser rifle in Italy. Luger did his best to get the rifle accepted, sadly without success, because they had already made their mind up to choose the Mandlicher. Interesting is that Luger describes in the letter his tactics, and that is that he tries to bribe the wives of the commission members with the promise of money and jewelry if the husbands would vote for the Mauser. After, let's say, failing to sell the rifle in Italy, Luger spent a lot of time in Oberndorf and trying basically to suck up to Mauser. So he tried to approach Mauser and make suggestions and just try to get himself inside the close ring of associates of Mauser. Mauser didn't like Luger. He saw through it, he was irritated, and they didn't get along, so Luger was eventually sent back to Leuwe, where he started work on improving the Borchardt pistol, with the result that we all know about the POET. Interesting, one day Mauser sent a number of rifles to Berlin, and then we have to understand that Mauser is part of the Leuwe conglomerate, was using the Leuwe head office in Berlin, just a stone's throw away from the Reichstag, to ship rifles to and from acceptance commissions and to make commissions in other countries. So at Mauser did, he had prepared a number of prototype rifles for testing by the British and the Americans. And what happened? Those rifles ended up in Berlin, and Luger took a long and very long look at rifles, made very careful notes of all the modifications to see if there was something new that he could get his hands on. What was interesting is that the rifles that were sent to Berlin, so for further testing in the UK and the US, had the third locking lug at the rear of the bolt included for the first time on Mauser rifles. And Luger thought, oh, well, that's interesting. Is it patented? Oh, no, there is no patent. Okay, I will take out the patent. So Luger took out, well, not a patent, a gebrauchsmuster on the third locking lug. Didn't say anything, let it go. And then with additional tests in 1896, again, this third locking lug became an issue. And part of the discussion, because one of the Mauser technicians said, well, oh, that's nothing new, and it can be removed, but it's stuck now. And Luger said, okay, it's my gebrauchsmuster, so I have the legal right to license it to you, but I haven't licensed it to you, so we need to speak. We know the number of the gebrauchsmuster. It was number 40,134. But until now we haven't found a physical copy of the document itself. It was lost in the German patent offices because of, let's say, a couple of world wars and a lot of fires. But the results are documented, however. So what did Georg Luger do? He wrote a nice, his lawyer wrote a nice letter to Mauser saying, okay, you are producing my gebrauchsmuster, the third lug. Let's talk about licensing, because I want to get paid for my idea. So you can understand that Paul Mauser exploded, because it's not a new idea. Mauser introduced it before Luger was even aware that it existed, and he just felt completely betrayed. Luger was also working for Leuwe, so Mauser felt that Leuwe was trying to pull one on him. Something else that was basically also a factor was that in the communication between Wilhelm and Paul Mauser in the old days, Wilhelm Mauser was always pushing Paul to patent every change that he made. And Paul sometimes was a bit lax on taking out the patents, and Wilhelm was constantly pushing him, okay, take out the patent, make sure you have it described, because the idea will get stolen and we'll make no money. So what happened, Paul Mauser said, well, Luger, you can go to hell, let's go to court. So a court case was launched. Mauser argued that the preliminary patent by George Luger had to be invalidated because it was not a new idea. And so on the 4th of April in 1898, almost 4 years after the incident in Berlin, a court case was held in Berlin, and there was an interesting group of people. One of the managers of DWM, Mr. Felix Heinisch, Fido Federley, the assistant of Paul Mauser, responsible for prototype and demo building, Max Kozengarten, DWM director, Waffenmeister Lindner, factory inspector Winterfeld, those were the guys who were present when the discussion between Luger and Federley took place. And also they invented Mr. Borchardt. Well, the answer of Mr. Borchardt was quite short. He said, well, I designed the Borchardt pistol in the past. I have nothing to do with further design and completely nothing to do with rifle design, so I cannot be of any help. So I'm not really sure what I'm doing here. Mr. Heinisch reported he had seen no evidence that Luger had applied for this patent after he studied the rifles. So the first accusation that Mauser had was that Luger based his gebrauchsmuster, his patent, on the modifications that Mauser had introduced. But he was unable to prove it. Bad for Mauser. Federley was also asked to testify, and he gave some personal info, which is interesting. He said, my name is Vito Federley, 38 years old, Catholic, worked for the plaintiff as a master gunsmith, and I am married to a niece of Paul Mauser's wife. But he had no further interest, financial interest, in the business or the gun. He said he had an order book with entries from 1894, where he says, okay, the three rifles were sent to Leuven in Berlin and had the three locking lugs because it is marked in the book. And he said, well, during the time of the trial, we looked up some old designs and we found a lock produced in 1888, which already had the third lug. So it's, we were already doing it before the Gebrauchsmuster was there. And then came the trick. Mauser lost the court case. Why did he lose? Well, the court ruled that although there was no evidence that the construction was not a new idea, and that was clear, the patent law of 1891 said that an idea cannot be registered if the idea or construction was already in use in Germany before the application date. And this is the crux, the three rifles that had the third stocking lug were not destined for Germany, they were destined for the US and the UK. So that technicality made that the judge ruled in favor of Lubbock and not in favor of Mauser. And furthermore, the court ruled that Lubbock was the first person to associate the third lug with the safety of the shooter. So yeah, unfortunately for Mauser, Mauser lost. And this was a very bitter loss. And it would have consequences long after. What we see here is a receipt signed by Georg Lubbock, January 1902, for 2,000 marks paid by Mauser as compensation for the third lug. So that's the way that Lubbock made his money, carefully and creatively patenting ideas that other people produced and then either suing or licensing the patent. So, the consequences. Okay, Paul Mauser was seriously pissed. Isidor Leuwe had to make a number of trips to Oberndorf and to calm Mauser down and to try and make sure that this problem would go away. So the only thing in the end he could do is make a couple of concessions, give Mauser a little bit more money, a little bit more influence in the company, doing some promises about future projects. And so Mauser was sort of quieted down for the moment. But Mauser had a nice trick up his sleeve. The C96 was ready for patenting in 1895. So what did Paul Mauser do? Normally speaking, it's a company product and the company would register the patent. And Paul Mauser said, if Lubbock can register his own patents while he's working for Leuven, I can do the same. So he deliberately took out the patent of the C96 in his own personal name. And that was not because he didn't want the Federalists to profit from it. It was purely done to get back at Leuven and get back at Lubbock, just to make a statement. Okay, you guys want to screw me, I will screw you back. So, result is Leuven again had to make a number of trips to Oberndorf, convincing Mauser to sign over the patent to the company. Mauser said, ah, okay, what do I get out of it? So he had to make more concessions to Mauser. And this is where Mauser made a critical mistake. Mauser retained the exclusive right to produce the C96 and also to determine the pricing of the C96 and also to control the licensing of the C96. So what did Leuwe do? He completely ignored the C96 where he could, because he couldn't make any money out of it. And Mauser was unable to find external producers because Leuwe was, let's say, working against it. So it was a small victory for Mauser, but in the end it cost him his own market. To illustrate it, this is an information page about the 7.62mm Mauser pistol, signed in 1912 by Georg Lubbock. And that was this part.